Hello, everybody. Isn't it great to be in California? So I was really glad when I saw we had a whole bunch of locals here. But how many people, for how many of you is this your first time in California? Isn't it cool? We've been here before. We had a UDS in Mountain View several years ago at the Google campus. But we've never been here in spring. And I have to say, it's quite a different experience. The Bay Area in spring is just gorgeous. The sunshine is so bright it makes your eyes water. Or maybe it's the spring pollen, or maybe it's just the residual pepper spray. But there's something magical about California. I spoke with some of the guys who were here last week and who rented a Mustang to take Highway 1, was it, up and down the coast. And I love that. So welcome to California. I remember coming here the first time many years ago during the dot-com explosion and just being wowed by the sort of sense of innovation and sort of potent creativity and technical excellence that is just pervasive around here. We are not far from Berkeley, the home of BSD Unix. And across the bay from their competitor, Stanford, which has done some other interesting things. So welcome to California. It's just fantastic for me to think how fast things are moving. The last 6 months have been the most exciting 6 months in Ubuntu history. So I was walking around some of the tables that we have from sponsors outside, and the HP guys told me that they can accelerate access to the beta cloud, which they're running on OpenStack on Ubuntu, for everybody who's here. So it's really worth stopping by the HP Cloud Services booth. And I also, if you stop by just next to them, there's an Intel booth, and they have some pretty awesome kit. It's a modular hypervisor server. So it's really playing to the story of density that is pretty much coming to define the state of the art in data centers. We've been working with them under a code name Manzanita, so it's fantastic to see some of that product actually now becoming available. So do stop by those booths and discover some of the cool things that people are doing with Ubuntu. We did something amazing. 12.04, in just so many ways, was awesome. And I know I'm going to miss people out, but I want to just celebrate some of the extraordinary things that happened there. First of all, I learned something completely unexpected, was that it is possible to have a rolling release that is usable every single day. So, Rick Spencer. I think I used the phrase privately, rolling release crack madness, and I was completely wrong. Rick, thank you very much for your vision in that. Making the release usable every day, making the commitment to have the development release usable every day, was a fundamental change in how we think of Ubuntu. It massively increased the number of people who are using the development release, and it changed the relationship that we have with those very super smart canaries, essentially. And as a result, I think you can actually feel the quality, not just in the final product, but in the whole run-up to the release. We also saw in the last 6 months, we saw Unity showing its strength when we brought it out at CES in the TV. I would never have thought that Ubuntu TV would be a global top trending item on Twitter, right next to Justin Bieber divorce or something. But there we were. And the next announcement for us on the TV will be when we actually are committing to ship it in volume somewhere in the world. Not just yet, but that work is on track and continuing. Then at MWC, Ubuntu for Android absolutely captured the headlines. There were multiple articles that sort of said, you know, what are the top three or top five things to see in Barcelona? And Ubuntu for Android just wowed the crowd. We had a crowd outside our booth right the way through. It was a culmination for us of 4 years' work with the ARM community, understanding how Ubuntu and ARM, how GNU Linux and ARM can come together and accelerate all sorts of goodness. Our vision is for a free software platform that just works everywhere, from the palm of your hand to the living room, and for all of the goodness, all of the innovation that that kind of platform could unleash. We also saw amazing stuff in the cloud. Where the OpenStack team? Where is the OpenStack team? Upstream, downstream. There we go. Welcome. It's fantastic to watch now all the reports of people spinning up their own clouds, test and dev clouds, private clouds, public clouds. We're changing the way people share and consume resources between themselves. I have a small cloud in the garage which serves as a backup heating system in the Isle of Man. So if it gets really cold there, I'll grant public access so that you can all spin up the hard drives and burn some electricity. And we saw the metal and the cloud coming together in Maz. Where's the Maz team? Over there. Well done. And we saw some pretty awesome work done for Ubuntu on AWS. So in places where people are starting to consume Ubuntu, making it much easier for them, making it more efficient, making the platform more reliable. The cloud is becoming the place where prototyping and development happen. So it's a perfect fit for us. And I think our team there did extraordinarily well. So we've always had four values in Ubuntu: freedom, collaboration, precision, and reliability. In the last release, I think we really gave meaning to precision and reliability. There's something that we often, it's easy to forget in the free software community, and that is that the last part is the hard part, right? It takes as much work to put all the pieces together in a way where anybody can consume them, and where we can confidently give them to everybody, as it does to build those pieces in the first place. And I think here we've pulled together a community that really understands the meaning of that. If you're going to give your personal time, if you're going to walk those 3 hours to be able to contribute that 1 hour, I think you want to know that your work is going straight into the hands of the most people possible. And here, we will reach 5 or 8 times as many places as any other project. This is a place that has real meaning, and it's pervasive. Jono called it out, the meaning of Ubuntu. So thank you to all of you who come here for that, because you add a great deal of richness and depth to this project. So for some time, we've been building up a series of big ideas in free software. Cadence is an idea that comes from the Agile community. It got adopted in GNOME. Then we said we would do it, the whole software universe. Again, people said that was crazy, but it's worked. Now we have the kernel on a Cadence. This is a meme that is running. Design. 4 years ago, we said design is going to be one of the key drivers to make free software better. We have an awesome design team, and in this last cycle, the relationship between design and engineering and the community really strengthened. So the design theater that Jono called out, I can highly recommend that to you. If you have a problem and you want to bounce ideas back and forth with designers, with community members, the design theater format is a great one to kind of get yourself into it. Design thinking is really about testing your assumptions. So when you listen to designers talk about how they evolve their ideas, it's very similar to what you hear when you listen to developers talking about agile development, iterations, testing, quick feedback, pivoting. So get along and take a look at that. But the focus for us now in this 2-year period is quality. And we made some profound shifts in our attitude to quality in Ubuntu in 12.04. And that forced profound shifts in our attitude to quality in places that feed important code into Ubuntu in 12.04. It led to all sorts of cool initiatives like this. This is open hardware. This is a remote controllable VGA connect and disconnect. So this is how we're testing multi-monitor. All of the specifications for this are freely available. Steve Conklin over there will give you the down and dirty. He may just have a few of these if you want to step up and do some automated testing of multi-monitor or other kinds of work. But this is a really cool idea that comes from this idea that we can empower people to participate in all sorts of new ways. Participate in design, participate in testing, participate in hardware. And we may see a lot more of that in future. So quality, we've learned, is a way of being. It's not something you bolt on afterwards. We didn't say we were going to give more time to quality in this release. We said we were going to do quality all the time. And that's a profound shift. It's a profound shift that over the next 2 years, I think, we're going to lead upstream. The tools around continuous integration, test automation, and the relationships that we can set up around those tools allow us to work with upstreams to say, okay, if you want to embrace this quality idea, this idea that your trunk should be usable every day, just like the Ubuntu development release should be usable every day. That means you can do daily builds, which are usable every day. And just like we saw a massive increase in the number of people using the daily build of Ubuntu, you will see a massive increase in the number of people using the daily build of your stuff, which means you'll get feedback faster when things are great, and feedback even faster when they need to be fixed. So this is a mission for us, to put quality really where it belongs, which is at the top, in the tree, upstream. The relationship between us and our upstreams now can span all of these areas, design, quality, and cadence. And I think that's a really important, profound shift that we've made. So I again want to call out, you know, they say quality starts at the top. Partly that means it has to be important to the people who lead. Rick Spencer, Pete Grainer, where's Pete? And your QA team for building this awesome infrastructure which lets us do all of this, which gives us that confidence that we're moving forward every day, and when we do take a step back, we catch it quickly. Thank you, and really well done. For upstreams that embrace this, we now have the ability to make stronger commitments to, for example, micro-release updates, where we have upstreams that understand the importance and the value of being able to deliver updates to their users in a stable release. If they can show that they have good policies around what changes between, you know, for example, GIMP 2.8.0 and 2.8.1, that micro-release, where we have upstreams that we can engage with around quality, we can do accelerated micro-release updates. And we can also, where we have upstreams that really embrace quality, we can do a tighter coupling between their release cycle and our release cycle. So I was really excited at the work in the OpenStack community around continuous integration, which a lot of us played a hand in. HP have said that this is an area that's particularly interesting for them. So I think there's a fruitful ground for a lot of collaboration in this area. So one of the great things that we did in 12.04 was something called Whoopsie Daisy. Where's Evan? Well done. Great. And what a delightful name, chap. So Whoopsie Daisy is essentially all about accelerating the process of finding out that something went wrong out there in our community, in our cloud of Ubuntu users. And we shifted our thinking on that to say, look, this is data that we're gathering. This is a big data problem. And so Apport got wrapped by Whoopsie Daisy, and we're now in a position where we're going to be able to build a big database of all of the crash information, essentially, live, in real time, as to what's happening in Ubuntu. I was chatting last night with Thomas from Google. He's here as part of the Gubuntu team. Thomas, where are you? Over here. Thomas is going to be talking a little bit later about some of the amazing things that they do in terms of how they deploy Ubuntu. And we were talking about early warning systems, canaries, figuring out when something's gone wrong. If you have that kind of safety harness, it gives you the confidence to move faster because you'll know if you break something. So I think Whoopsie Daisy is a really important step in letting us move faster with confidence, right? If an upstream delivers some goodness, we can integrate that goodness and deliver it, and we can know in minutes if there's an issue. We're delivering that potentially to millions of users, right? Using big data type analysis, we're going to be able to iterate on quality. Now imagine expanding that. Imagine expanding that so that an upstream can have a PPA And when one of their users is using a daily build from their PPA and it crashes, that crash report and core dump are instantly available for analysis to that upstream community. So I think we want to generalize this, and this is a big challenge that I want to throw out to us as a community. How do we instrument Ubuntu? And there are some profound and difficult questions here. For example, what are the rules around access to that data? We want to. The commitment I want us to make is that we will instrument Ubuntu deeply. We'll make it easy for people to opt in to help make Ubuntu better. We'll make it easy for any person in the world who is an accredited researcher to get access to the data. We'll make it easy for upstreams, for Debian maintainers, for Ubuntu maintainers to essentially add the hooks for instrumentation. So the idea is that we can crowdsource goodness, and we can do this in a very modern way. There are some hard questions there around data governance. There's some hard questions there around the tooling and the technology. But we can solve that. You know, that's fully within the sort of scope of challenges we have taken on and solved in the past. So instrumentation is going to be a core theme for us. Another key theme for us is a phase change that's happening in IT generally. And it's about scale. You'll hear terms like scale out and hyperscale. What's happening is that the number of nodes, the number of computers that people are managing on any given day is accelerating. And as it accelerates, the nature of our relationship with it changes. Managing 10 servers is different to managing 100 servers, but it's profoundly different to managing 100,000 servers. And somewhere between 100 and 100,000, ice becomes water, and the tools, the way of thinking, needs to change. And Google pioneered this in the late 90s, thinking profoundly differently about scale, about the way they manage data at scale, the way they manage hardware at scale. And it's increasingly obvious to me that this is something that's happening not just to the Facebooks and the Googles and the Amazons of the world, but it's happening in even modest businesses and data centers. Big data is a profound shift in the way we, in the aspirations that we set for data harnessing and data management. You know, we used to say, well, there's a small amount of precious data that we will put in a very high availability data store. Now we say, we want to gather everything. We want to know about everything, and then we want to attack that with machine analysis, machine learning. So the hardware world is changing. The hardware world is adapting to this hyperscale demand, and we're seeing massive changes in density. So this is a challenge for us. This is something that we can respond to. This is something that essentially is a challenge to us. We produce an operating system that suddenly has to be productive in a hyperscale environment. You know, it's one thing, we made Ubuntu easy to install, but it's a pain to install it, even if it's easy, if you have to do it 100,000 times. So can we get that server installed down to underneath 1 minute? There's a big challenge for us. Can we make it so that an Ubuntu image can boot in any environment in the data center, discover everything it needs to know, configure itself appropriately? Can we essentially bring cloud thinking to the data center? That was what MAZ was about. And it's what a lot of the work that we're doing in terms of with communities who focus on scale out, like Hadoop, is all about. So there's some really interesting problems there for us in networking. Do we have the right code to support data centers where you might have thousands of machines in one rack and hundreds of racks of them? Those are the kinds of challenges that I hope you'll be thinking about during the course of the week. So in that spirit, there have been some major announcements in the last couple of months. HP announced a project, Moonshot, and that is about bringing a new generation of server-class processors from Intel and from ARM into the data center, optimized for this kind of hyperscale, scale-out environment. And I'm really delighted that today we have a world first. I want to invite up onto the stage one of the pioneers in this field, the co-founder of Calzada, Mr. Larry Wakelius. Larry, do you want to come up?
Morning, Mark.
Welcome.
Thank you.
So today we have a bit of an unveiling, a bit of a surprise for people. Should we?
We do.
Let's do it. Right, one,
ready?
Two, three.
All right. So this is a 48-node, 192-core CalZeta server. It fits in a standard 2U form factor, has integrated SATA for storage, and each individual node can run in 5 watts. So instead of having your cloud in the garage, you can actually bring this one in the house, Mark.
Here we go.
And each node is running 1204 with a range of applications and user stacks that are tremendous for this this type of system.
So so with this configuration, in a full rack, how many nodes would there be in that rack?
With this configuration, you can get 1,000 nodes. And there are other partners that we have that have even denser implementations. So your description of hundreds of thousands of nodes in the data center is real.
So there's the challenge for us. Are you guys up for it? All right. Can you tell us a little bit about the specific innovation that you've brought to this class?
There's a couple things we've really focused on. So one is our fabric. If you look closely at the system, you don't see a lot of cables and interconnects getting in the way of the system itself. So we've integrated a fabric on every single node that enables node-to-node connectivity. It gives high bandwidth, low latency, and maps very well to the big data type problems, because fundamentally, those are data problems and challenges. And we've done everything to bring as much I/O capability to this type of system as possible. The other key thing with a large, dense systems like this is management. So we've integrated a management engine, full IPMI and DCMI support for easy use of existing applications to enable data center managers to maintain, control, and optimize their systems right out of the chute.
So you guys have been here for a number of UDSs. Can you talk a little bit about how working with the community has shaped your thinking and led to this unveiling?
It's really appropriate that we're here today. I think if you go back to Canonical in 2008 announcing support for ARM, our first UDS was 2009, not long after a company was founded. And fundamentally, we've really been able to work with folks in this room, the community at large, to bring together the kind of efficiency and capability. There's things like Linux container support that some of you in the room here have been able to drive and enable OpenStack support. From our team, we're mainline in Linux kernel. One of our lead kernel engineers, Rob Herring, is maintainer for device tree. We've upstream Pixie support. We've really driven to a standard view of servers in the ARM community to enable this community and really leverage a lot of the work that you've done. And we're truly honored to be here today to recognize that.
And when will Claire and I be able to start the debate about where this goes in the living room?
We're going to make that really easy for you. We're going to move fast. So in fact, this month, we'll be getting a system out to the team in Lexington, Mass. For builds and support there. So. And Robbie will help you out in Austin. We'll maybe get you your own personal one, too. So we really are going to do everything we can to enable folks here. Beyond that, we've talked a little bit about Moonshot here this morning. The HP Discovery Labs, obviously, will be coming online shortly. And that's another tremendous alignment between Ubuntu, Canonical, and CalZeta with the work going on there. And we're looking at later this summer of potentially a public cloud access for even more availability.
Well, thank you very much for the role that your team has played in shaping our thinking.
And thank you.
Thank you for coming today.
Thanks.
So cloud and hyperscale are sort of two faces of the same thing. It's about focusing on compute, storage, as malleable resources, things that you can shape, things that you can move around. We've seen awesome work by the OpenStack team, awesome work by the Awesome team. One of our contributions to OpenStack, helping to enable people to work with Amazon APIs on OpenStack clouds. There is still a great deal of work to be done. Fulsome is going to be an anchor point of 1210, but we're also going to backport it to 1204, so that you can. We've made the commitment that you'll be able to get the next 3 releases of OpenStack on 1204, so people can deploy Essex today, Fulsome tomorrow, without changing the rest of user space, and run through GNH before 1404. So there's in particular, I want to call attention to tomorrow's Cloud Day. We're having a special track where we've invited speakers and guests just to focus on cloud. Going to have some awesome presentations there. The CTO of the HP Cloud Services will be talking. We'll have presentations from Rackspace and many other companies that are innovating and pioneering and driving and underpinning this revolution, cloud computing. So mobile. I don't have an Ubuntu phone in my pocket. I wish I did. But I don't yet have an Ubuntu phone in my pocket. However, it is absolutely clear that people are building phones and other mobile gadgets using Ubuntu as a core. And we are going to build an Ubuntu experience for mobile platforms. So we should be thinking about that right now. We should be thinking about how our core infrastructure, which is part of the deep relationship between us and Debian, how we can get that core infrastructure to absolutely rock in a mobile world. So this is a conversation that we need to have with our upstreams. This is a conversation we need to have with Debian. And this is a conversation that we're in a good position to lead. There is a real use case for Ubuntu in environments where battery life is critical, where the number of wake-ups is critical, where we think very carefully about how we boot, how we upgrade, how we update. We want to preserve all of the goodness, all of the community-powered goodness of Ubuntu, but also make it awesome for people building mobile gadgets. So there's another challenge for you guys. We did some fantastic work in 1204 around battery life and wake-ups, focused on the laptop market. Now let's take that even further and broaden the conversation to make a platform that anybody anywhere can consume and use. So freedom and collaboration, two of our core values. In 1204, we launched something really, really innovative, the HUD. We've had feedback from UX researchers all over the world, including folks who work for very substantial brands in technology, saying that they think this has legs. They think this idea can run. The first version of it was to prove the concept. And we thought we could introduce it without changing people's existing patterns unless they wanted to start dipping a toe into the HUD. It looked like this in 1204. We did a bunch of user research. Oren Horov, where's Oren? Oren, tall guy, baggy pants some days, is going to be leading the discussions around the HUD and how we iterate the HUD in this cycle. Based on the user research, we found some really interesting things about how we're presenting essentially what here are our menu items. How people read those, how they parse them, what's working, what's not working. There's some really key challenges for us there. Making search great, and we can do that in part through that instrumentation exercise, but also iterating and improving the user experience. So as a teaser trailer, this is what the HUD might look like in 1210. In 1204, we essentially said, let's parse the menus of an application. We've done all of this work to essentially let the applications express their menus, their commands, their actions as a service. So let's parse that and provide a new way of getting access to it. But in 1210, we can go further. We can actually really start to present the sort of user experience. And we can give application designers the ability to say, this is how I want to express stuff in the HUD, much better than it would be expressed in a menu. And we can go even further, right? In the HUD 1204, we were just wrapping around menus, but we can start to wrap around dialog boxes and toolbars. So we can really give expression to some of the key user journeys, working with cool tools like GIMP 2.8 and others. So there's going to be a very exciting round of research, prototyping, and development here, and I'd really encourage you to get to Oren's sessions. As part of the user testing of the really future prototypes, though, some of the code did leak to Hollywood and may have showed up in a movie theater near you. Also, you may have seen this picture of Claire beta testing the HUD 5.0. We're also going to evolve our look and feel. What we have right now is beautiful. It's funny, we did some user testing with a legend in, I actually get goose pimples thinking about it. We did some user testing with a legend in computer science recently. I'm not going to say who, but it was, you know, there were about six of us there who were, you know, a bit awestruck. We were studying how he works in a super productive kind of way. He's got a completely customized setup, and there's no way we could deliver that to a global audience, but we could infer deep ideas in terms of what he was doing for productivity, for focus, and it was really interesting to see correlations between the way he's customized things for himself and some of the core ideas in Unity design. Expressing focus, letting the content express itself, minimizing the amount of clutter. These things all showed up in his configuration as well. And we mapped some of his data into 1204. He was running a very old version of Ubuntu. We mapped some of his data into 1204 to sort of let him experiment with that. So we're starting to look at Unity from a user testing point of view, not just through the eyes of beginners, but also through the eyes of people who are, you know, deeply rooted in technology and professionals. The first thing that he said when he saw Unity was, wow, it's really beautiful. And you could just see how excited everybody got. This is something new, right? I knew that we weren't going to be able to change the way someone who has very specific work habits work, but to have that appreciated is wonderful. These are some renders of the evolving look and feel of 1210, and the design team, the art magicians are going to be here talking about that. We have some new ideas in terms of how we integrate themes of paper and Aurora and origami into our theme. So if you're interested in that, then please participate in those sessions. So this is Ubuntu. Be excellent to each other. I always close on that, but today I can say it in a new way. Be charming. There will be a charm school for those of you who aren't, in, you know, who don't get the joke. The work that the Juju team has done is extraordinary. George blogged the other day to say, this is going to change the way people use Ubuntu on the server. I've heard lots of people say that the way they spin up a temporary instance now is to Juju deploy SSH into the cloud and then SSH to it, and they have a vanilla instance, which they can then just destroy, tear down trivially. So we really are providing the tools for DevOps, the tools that will accelerate the consumption of the goodness. You know, if you imagine a pipeline from an upstream developer through the packaging and distribution, through the deployment and configuration to the end user, we are tightening that pipeline. And that's what DevOps is all about. We're seeing an explosion in the number of charms that we have in what we jokingly call the charm farm, right? This library in the sky of charms that you can just deploy with a single command and connect up to your other charms. The challenge for us in this cycle is to bring all of the goodness of community governance and process and quality to that, so that when people Juju deploy a Rabbit or Juju deploy Hadoop or Juju deploy OpenStack, they have the same expectation of quality as when they apt-get it. This is a really interesting new development. We're opening the field for crowdsourcing from purely developers and people who understand packaging and integration, now to people who understand deployment and DevOps. Imagine if you could deploy Postgres in the way that the guy who wrote the Postgres book recommends you deploy it, and that deployment could be live, improving over time, so that every time you deploy, your Postgres is leaner, meaner, more efficient. For those of you who haven't read the series of blog posts about how OMG Ubuntu essentially mapped themselves from a traditional sort of deployment of WordPress into a deployment in the cloud with Juju, and how rapidly their costs dropped as the Juju charms for WordPress and MySQL and load balancing proxies and so on improved. It makes great reading, and it's a really profound story for us in 1210 and forward to 1404. So that is a wrap from me. Let's make a wonderful Quetzal, and thank you very much. Have a great week. Oh! Somewhat by accident, I get to say one more thing. This is something amazing. This is a beautiful Dell XPS laptop, which will be the prize. Well, not this one. This is mine. my precious. This will be the prize for the Juju contest, which is running this week. So if you haven't entered that contest yet, find something really interesting, something that you use every day, and charm it up. Charm School, I think, is Wednesday. When is Charm School, George?
All day, Monday and Tuesday. We're going to do them on the fly because there's too many.
All right. Rolling releases of Charm School. Dell has a project which Bart and George is going to be talking about, and I'd encourage you to go to his session. Trying to bring DevOps into the Linux world and kind of retrieve them from Mac OS, where they've briefly gotten entangled. We have an incredible story that we can tell for cloud developers on Ubuntu, with Juju, LXC, for microclouds on the laptop, so that you can model out tens or hundreds of nodes running on your laptop in memory as a real configuration, load balancing proxies, scaled out Hadoop, everything you need, multiple databases all connected to each other without blasting all of that stuff onto your own sort of normal file system. There's an incredible story to be told there for DevOps productivity. So get one of these, get to Barton's session and enjoy it, and may the best charmer win. Jono, thank you. Thank you.